Okay, I'm going to give you a short entry into Georges Bataille's base materialism. And this is from a short essay called Base Materialism and Gnosticism, which can be found in this particular book right here. It's a little bit difficult to see because of the reflection. It's Visions of Excess, Selected Writings, 1927 to 1939, and it really is a mix of very short essays. That's what it is, and a lot of it really gets close to surrealism. There's some anthropology or anthro-theology, possibly. Lots of interesting speculations relating to esotericism, Gnosticism, those sorts of things. But I believe that Bataille does want to make it very clear that he stands apart from any kind of superstitious belief in those sorts of things. He's wanting to use them politically and as an exercise in expanding one's mind and seeing things differently, and indeed perhaps closer to, I hesitate to say closer to as they really are, but closer to what may serve our human interests if we were to see them differently. So he wants to draw from ideas of the historical past, and indeed the very distant past, the ancient societies, and their ideas. But put them into a modern context for modern usage. And above all, to make us see what we refuse to see, what we are not inclined to see. Largely because we are creatures of habit, I suppose. But in any case, we are embedded in power relations that give us our identities. And we become, in a way, hypnotized into those identities. And as a result, it becomes difficult for us to see something other than what we're conditioned or trained to see, which means that we keep perpetuating the same power relations that have kept us captive and that have reduced our freedom and range of being. It is interesting that Bataille introduces his short essay by talking about the sense of there being a prison and a prison guard, or the concept and what is denoted, the material that is denoted by the concept. And so he starts off with this seemingly conceptual, some might even say linguistic, representation. But indeed, it's more than that, because he refers to Hegel. He refers to Hegel's concept of God, to Hegel's idealism, and to the way that it gives a program for material life, what material life needs to conform to in order to actualize itself in order to get where it's supposed to get in historical time. So we are talking, in effect, about a dominant idea that takes hold of material reality, guides it and directs it, and leads it to a particular end point. Now, that is Hegelianism, but a lot can be done with Hegelianism. We don't need to keep it in that raw, original form. And indeed, Hegelianism, in its raw, if I can use that word, it's not quite raw, but it's the original. In the original Hegelianism, the structure was idealistic, which means that the higher parts of one's being, the concepts, and the sense of God and deity, for Hegel was a Christian, are required to dominate the lower parts of your being, and the lower parts being your material substance. So the structure is idealism, is the mechanism that has been valorized, that has been charged up and given import. And materialism is not in itself anything to Hegel. It's material is what is actually managed by the concepts, and it submits to the concepts, one might even say. I'm using a lot of liberty here with trying to express the dominance of idealism at the expense of the material substance of our human existence. So submitting to concepts, submitting to God, submitting to the jailer, this was all the recipe for human development in the not too distant past when Hegel was around. And now Bataille looks into the archaic world, looks at Gnosticism, and I really don't have time to go into his analysis of Gnosticism and how he saw that to relate to Christianity. But I do have time and space at this moment for the delving into the psychology of base materialism. So I'll do that. And what Bataille wants to do is to release us from the jailer, release us from the concept that would jail us. And the way the concept jails us is, one of the fundamental core ways is that it demands from us that we seek what is superior. We aim higher. We submit ourselves, therefore, to higher concepts, higher ideas, things that are not base, degrading, low aspects of our being that are said to be worthy of being despised, because they are not the elevated parts. They are not the parts that are high, beautiful, wondrous, masterful, controlled and controlling. It seems very natural as humans. We want to aspire to what's higher, but in fact, when we do that, we don't understand, it would seem, what we are doing. We think we are doing one thing and we are doing another thing. We aspire to reach higher, to get better. And in fact, to a large extent, we just put ourselves in jail. We put ourselves in submission to a concept, to reason, to something that is actually outside of ourselves. So we might ask, why does Bataille introduce this concept of base materialism as an expression of Gnosticism for our current era, or indeed for his era, the 20th century, the early to mid 20th century? Well, it's so that we can find a way out of this this mode of slavery, this mode of submission to the jailer, without losing the aspect of human vitality that makes life worth living. So base materialism, I've got a few notes here. Here are some aphorisms, as it were, to help understand base materialism. What is lower cannot ape a given authority. So if we opt for what is lower, conceptually, we find that we don't end up subscribing to authoritative dictums and laws regarding our behavior, because it's lower. It can't. It's, you know, it's just a monkey. It's just a donkey. It's not going to be able to submit to any given authority. It's incapable. It's lower. So you identify with what is lower. You identify with what is incapable of submitting. And then there's the other little phrase I wrote down, so that you also need to avoid submitting to the principle of materialism if you want to be a materialist. If you think, I'm going to be a radical leftist materialist, that is submitting to a superior principle. And then, so you're aiming for something higher, even though you identify with materialism, which is symbolically lower in terms of the history of Western philosophy. You still have this goal, this ambition to embrace what is true, and therefore you are aiming for a superior principle, and you will submit to the jailer in terms of that superior principle. So once again, you're being dominated from the outside by this fundamental structure of dualism that you've accepted, this idealism at the top versus the materialism at the bottom. Only this time you're identifying with the bottom, but you've turned it into a principle of true and good and just and, you know, righteousness. And that's a submission. That is, unfreedom. So you don't want to submit there. I've just written down, so materialism is not to be a superior principle. So you don't want to submit to anything superior. You want to hold your own in terms of what you are. And in order to do that, you need to have this kind of image of yourself that you will identify with, it's lower, but it's lower in the sense of it's not a intellectual or conceptual principle. It's just a destabilizing principle where you say, I'm just going to, like in martial arts, you sink your weight lower and you stabilize yourself, but in the same way you destabilize the authority that's trying to grab hold of you. So it's a different way of looking at it. So it's not that you destabilize yourself. You destabilize the concept, you destabilize what's trying to push you into conformity and into submission. I know that when I've given up on things, when I've fell into a mode of pessimism, I've actually found, there's a lot of freedom there in comparison to what I had been finding myself in. So that sense of darkness, the sense of I don't know. You know, somebody says to me, but you need to conform to what's true, and otherwise give an account of yourself or whatever. And I would say, you know, you start to get to a point in your life where you say, but I'm tired of giving an account of myself. I'm tired of pretending I know everything, that I'm complying with my own principles on the basis of what I know. So I'm just going to say, I don't know, because I actually am just a human being and I can't take into consideration all these different forces and unknown forces and these effects that may be dominant at any particular time. I'm not the one that orchestrated them. I didn't bring them into being, and yet they have that impact on me. You know, they've changed me. They've some way smacked me around in some ways, but I didn't make them. I didn't invent them. And, you know, I'm not accountable for them. So there's that sense you can say, I don't know. I'm under a dark cloud. I really simply have no idea. And yet here I am. Me, Jennifer, I'm still a material thing. I still exist. I still have that right to exist, and I don't need to account for myself, for my existence. So there's that sense where pessimism, the negativity of pessimism and the negativity of non-knowledge can actually be liberating forces. And I do believe that that is really what Bataille was getting at with that essay, and indeed with other concepts that he himself developed in other books.